Good morning. It's good to have you all with us this morning. It's good to see so many smiling faces here. If you feel like you're uncomfortable next to somebody, just move over a little bit. You'll be fine. We make sure that we spray down these pews after a service. And tonight, don't forget, we will be having services tonight, starting again. Deacon's meeting, 7, right after services, I believe. Is that correct, Kenny? All right. So, as I said, we're going to kind of slowly move into these things. We will be having a business meeting in the evening next Sunday night. No meal. Okay? No meal. Just the business meeting for a while. But it is good to see you all here this morning. Several things that I want to make sure that you all see on the bulletin. Notice that Finance Committee, we're going to be meeting at 6 o'clock on Thursday. Remind me Wednesday, somebody. Okay, so I won't forget. Forgot last time. Then, of course, our business meeting. Vacation Bible School team is going to be meeting 6 p.m. on the 18th. Notice the rest of the things going on. I'm beginning two new series on messages now, starting Sunday night, or actually starting this morning. This morning's is going to be the first series of what the church does in the end times. How do we live in the end times? And we are in the end times, in case you all haven't figured it out. So what is the church to do in the end times? Second one is 37 prophecies you need to know about the end times on Sunday nights. Okay, so we're going to be kind of delving into what's going on around us. And hopefully you all will be able to gain some information, kind of give you encouragement and strengthen you as this time goes on. We live in some tough times, some unusual times, but folks, we don't need to fear because we know who's in charge. And we've read the end of the book, we know who wins. So just hang in there. All right, I'm ready to start. Are you, brother? Video.
Says the rich rules over the poor and the borrower is the slave of the lender. In Proverbs 13:7, which says, one pretends to be rich and yet has nothing. Another man pretends to be poor and yet has great wealth. And finally, Proverbs 21:20, which says, precious treasure and oil are in a wise man's house, but a foolish man devours all that he has. These lessons led Dave to create Financial Peace University. 78% of Americans say that they live paycheck to paycheck. 70% of married couples don't follow a budget consistently. 44% of Americans said that they would have to borrow money to cover a $1,000 emergency. Cromountain Baptist Church will be hosting a Financial Peace University class beginning Sunday, September the 13th at 4:30 p.m. We will meet every Sunday evening at 4:30 for 9 weeks. We'll learn how to eliminate debt, save money, build wealth, and give generously using biblical wisdom. So visit fpu.com/112-1790. That also can be found in your bulletin, so don't feel the need to memorize it or anything. Or if you have any questions, feel free to call me or ask me in person. Thank you.
Mighty is our God, mighty is our King, mighty is our Lord, ruler of everything, and glory to our God, glory to our King, glory to our Lord, ruler of everything. His name is higher, higher than any other name. His power is greater, for he's created everything. Yes, mighty is our God, mighty is our King, mighty is our Lord, ruler of glory to our God, glory to our King, glory to our Lord, ruler of everything. I love to tell the story of unseen things and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it is true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell Jesus and his love, and I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seen hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest, and when in scenes of glory I sing the new song, will be the old story,
Let me take a breather. So for the last couple of weeks, the Lord's been asking me some hard questions and laying a lot of things on my heart. And one of the things he laid on my heart was, since all the things that are going on, how many times have I specifically prayed for the pandemic to end? And it was a hard question. I prayed for the ones around me. I pray for the people that get texts that need healing. I pray for our church and our church family. But how many times have I specifically said, Lord, end the pandemic, and let's let the world get back to normal? And the answer was probably as many times I could count on one hand. And if we're not praying for that specifically, or world-changing events, then who's gonna? Because as Christians, we should be praying and asking, like the person we're talking to, or the one we're talking to, can fix it. Because he can. Because the person we are praying to is the one that can fix everything and anything. So I've been trying to focus in on making sure I pray that the pandemic will end and that God will end it. I've been praying a lot for our world leaders. I've been praying a lot for our country. And it's because if we're not, who is? Today's verses is Mark 11, 22 through 24. Jesus replied to them, "Have faith in God. I assure you, if anyone says to this mountain, 'Be lifted up and thrown into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes, that is what he will see happen. Therefore, I tell you, all things you pray and ask for, believe that you have received them, and you will have them." So let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we know, God, that you can do anything. You created everything, Lord. And we ask, God, that you would end the pandemic, Lord, that you would help us to all get back to the way of life that we long for, Lord. We pray, God, that you would end this, and that you would guide and direct us, Lord, to be your hands and your feet, to do your work, God, in the world. We pray, God, that you would help us to not get caught up in having tunnel vision, Lord, and that we would look at the whole picture and pray for big, big things, Lord, that will change the world, Lord, because you can. We pray, God, that we would be the ones that would help to do that, Lord, that you would use us, God. We love you, Lord. And we thank you. And we ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
It is always good to be in the house of the Lord and sing praises. Amen. This morning, as we wrap up, let's sing praises to our Lord.
I sing praises to your name, oh Lord, praises to your name, oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name. Oh, Lord.
just once more, we're going to ask the musicians to fade out. We just want the Lord to hear us this morning, all right? Let's give glory to Him. Amen. I give glory to Your name, O Lord. Glory to Your name, O Lord. For Your name is great and greatly to be praised. Yes, I give glory to Your name, O Lord. Glory to Your name, O Lord. For Your name is great and greatly to be praised. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, ladies. The longer I serve you, the sweeter he grows. And I want you to know that that is still true today, as it was yesterday. The longer we serve the Lord, the sweeter he'll grow. My message today is basically a preparatory message to dealing with the 37 prophecies that you need to know about on Sunday nights that I'm going to be preaching. 37 means that it will probably take us through the rest of the year each Sunday night because we have interruptions in there. You know, we have usually our business meeting one Sunday night, and then who knows, we might have a singing group come in one Sunday night. But I know we got one coming Sunday morning, October the 4th. The Abundant group that was here, they're coming back. Going to be for a morning worship. We want you to keep that in mind. They say, what are we going to do with all the people come in? We're going to praise the Lord for them. Amen. You know, I've gotten tired of being scared about COVID. And I'll tell you why. They've not yet proved to me that this is not more than just a souped up flu that goes around from time to time. They've used it to confuse us. As I've watched all of the media and stuff going on, you know what I did? What I've picked out? There are certain folks trying to be prophetic in what is going on, and yet they're failing because they don't use the Word of God. So we're going to talk about what a prophet is. What was a prophet yesterday, and what is a prophet today? We're going to come from one of the prophets of the Old Testament, the book of Amos. Amos was a prophet of the Old Testament, and he had these words to say, starting in verse 3 of chapter 3. Can two walk together unless they agreed? Will a lion roar in the forest where he has no prey? Will a young lion cry out of his den if he has caught nothing? Will a bird fall into a snare on the earth where there is no trap for it? Will a snare spring up from the earth if it has caught nothing at all? If a trumpet is blown in the city, will not the people be afraid? If there is calamity in the city, will not the Lord have done it? Surely the Lord God does nothing unless he reveals his secret to his servants, the prophets. A lion has roared. Who will not fear? The Lord God has spoken. Who can but prophesy? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for these words from hundreds of years ago as Amos stood before the people of Israel and as he prepared to speak the judgments that were upon those around Israel and those people of Israel who had disobeyed God, had fallen after other gods, and had forsaken the Lord God Almighty. Father, we just ask for us to better understand how our word today can reach the lost and keep them from forsaking the Lord God. Help us to understand better who we are and what we do when we speak the word of God today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now the role of Israel's prophets included its most illustrious Hebrews, from Abraham to Jesus. In one sense, all of God's leaders are prophets. Since the Hebrew word nabai translates to prophet, comes from a Hebrew root that means to speak. To speak. Now, in a larger context then, anyone who speaks for God is a prophet. Anyone who shares the word of God with somebody else is being a prophet. The Bible even speaks of, over in Corinthians, of the gift of prophecy. And it is a word of encouragement to the church that is given to someone from the word of God, because it doesn't come just from a dwelling in the mind. They give a prophecy, it has to have the word of God with it. You don't prophesy unless you prophesy out of the Word of God. That's the key to prophecy today. Today we're seeing a lot of people say, I predict. Watch out when they say those words. Watch out when they use that phrase, I predict. Because it's not coming from God. Because they just told you who it's coming from with the first word, I. We're seeing a lot of that on television today. We're seeing a lot of that in the media today, telling us that this is what's going to happen, this is how it's going to happen. Folks, they're not prophets. They're false prophets today. And there are false churches today. There are churches that are going against the Word of God, yet declaring they're still a Christian church. When you abandon the Word of God, when you stop giving the directions and the guidelines of the Word of God in the Bible, folks, you have lost your right to be called a church of Jesus Christ, because you no longer are speaking the truth. And we have many, even in our mainline denominations, that are going that way. We cannot declare what is wrong right, because the Word of God tells us what's right. And when we go against the Word of God, then literally we have lost our credentials as a true church. And we've got some out there today. So there are some things about a prophet that we need to know. There were false prophets back in the history of the Old Testament as well. Jesus used the term in his Sermon on the Mountain. These false prophets were intensely nationalistic and were optimistic concerning the nation's destiny, whether or not the people obeyed the Lord's commands or not. False prophets want to create an agenda that'll make themselves famous and will support the national agenda. We've got a lot of them out there today. We see them every day on television, on the news. This is what we must do. This is what we must do. Key word. A prophet starts with this: thus saith the Lord. If it doesn't come out of the Word of God, it's not a true prophecy. There are preachers today which are true prophets that are speaking the truth. I support John MacArthur's test of the challenge in California to not meet in the church and to not preach and to not sing. They'd have a fit if they were over here today, wouldn't they? Because we praised God this morning. We worshiped. We sang. Anytime a government starts to step in upon the church and sell it, it cannot meet, it cannot sing, it cannot preach, they've overstepped their bounds, and we have a right to resist unto the fullest. Because they've left the First Amendment and they've left the Word of God. So what is a prophet? First of all, a prophet's a person. God did more than send messengers or messages to Israel. He sent people. The sermon one delivers is never any stronger than the life one leads. Think about this now. The sermon one delivers is never any stronger than the life one leads. An older preacher took a young preacher that he would take him on a preaching expedition. They walked through the town for several hours. When they finished, the young man said, "When are we going to start preaching?" The older man said, "We have been preaching. Everywhere we have walked, people have seen us and reflected on the kind of life we live." Remember, young man, that the greatest sermon you'll ever preach is in the life that you live. That follows pretty closely to some words that a good friend of mine, a college professor, said. The greatest sermon you'll ever preach will be someday when you walk down the streets of a city or town where you are pastor. You won't hear it, but somebody will remark to a friend, "There goes our pastor. He is a man who lives what he preaches." If you're not living what you preach, then you better check your life. You better check what you're preaching. Because if we're not preaching the Word of God as we go, then what are we doing? God's prophets were people of unquestionable integrity. There's absolutely no question about their moral standards, which causes us today to look at some that we have heard that call themselves preachers on the televisions and elsewhere that don't live a moral life, or else say that these things are all right because the morality has changed, therefore we can adapt to the new morality. Folks, there is no new morality. It's the old morality of the Canaanites, of those that worshipped other gods. It is a moving back instead of forward. It's going back to some of the old sin and saying it is all right. The prophets of that day were one who literally had a moral standard. Ralph Waldo Emerson says, "Your actions speak so loud that I can't hear a word you say." Think about that, Christians. As we live out in this world, people are watching us. I'm reading a book by General McGinnis, one of our great generals that led in our nation, our Colonel McGinnis. He talked about the persecution that's going on in other places of the world concerning Christians. Do you know right now that they have almost eliminated the Christian faith in several of the Far East, Near East countries? Islam, those that are, worship Muhammad, that are Muslim, that are radical and also of the strong beliefs, have been literally killing Christians by the hundreds in some of these countries. And it goes on all the time. And yet we don't hear an outcry from the world concerning that. Do you know what the Crusades were all about, folks? Some say, well, that was when the Christians messed up and they started messing with the Muslims and decided to throw them out. For 400 years, Christianity held back its attack upon Muslims as they took over the world one country at a time. 400 years they tolerated Sharia law in places where it should not be. It tells me that America is dealing with the same problem today. We have some states that are now allowing Sharia law to be a part. Folks, it is a step out of the Muslim Old Testament world that they're beginning to take over America one state at a time. And we need to open our eyes and our mouths and say no more. That's it. Why? The Crusades were because the Christians were finally brought to a place where they had to retrieve all of the holy sites in Israel because the Muslims were destroying them. The Church of the Sepulchre was being destroyed at that point in time. The Crusades were not vindictive. The Crusades were going back to conquer back the areas of Christianity that still existed. Do I believe Muslims are people? Yes, I do. I believe Muslims can be converted to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hundreds are doing so. There are many that are stepping out away from their faith and accepting Jesus. They realize they've been lied to, that Satan had pulled the blinders over their face. And I believe that they can become faithful followers of Christ. But we must realize we're dealing with an ideology that preaches another religion, another faith, another God. Allah is not the same God as our God. He never has been. They may take us off the air for me saying that. But the truth is, my friends, Allah is not the same as our God. Allah is really a moon god that was worshipped many years before the time of Muhammad. So they are worshipping another god and trying to impose the worship of that god upon us as Christians because we believe in the one true God. They are false prophets. The message of the prophet is simple. He speaks for God, from God. God is holy. That's the first part of his message. Anytime you deal with a prophet, he's going to tell you that God is holy. Thus saith the Lord. The word holy means other than. Other than. But it also means more. The moral nature of God is included in his holiness. A people will become like the God that they worship. Think about that. The people will become like the God they worship. And look at the God that they were worshiping in the Old Testament. The gods of sexuality. The gods of perversity. The gods of physical immorality. The gods of sexual orgy. All of these were being worshiped by the Canaanites. That's why God, when he sent the Israelite people into the land of Canaan, told them, go destroy them all. Destroy them all. You know, we look back on that and said, how could God do that? You got to realize that the Nephilim were still there at that time. The giants were there. And they are the mixed blood that came from the angels that came in with mankind. These are the ones that were always causing problem. In the Philistines, there were five great giants that were actually the kings over the five Philistine cities. And they were a part of Goliath's kinship. Matter of fact, four of them were his brothers. That's why when David picked up five stones instead of four, because he knew not only would he have to take on Goliath, he was going to have to take on the family. Yeah. Folks, when you've got a family that's worshiping another god, you've got to deal with the root of the problem. Amen. And so he was prepared if the other brothers were going to come. Eventually, David did overcome. If you read in 1 and 2 Samuel, you'll find that before David's death that he actually did overcome all of the giants of the land. So God gave him that mission to take that mixed kind of blood out so that it would no longer affect the people of Israel. But these gods, other gods, little gods, as we call them, are gods that are immoral and want to destroy mankind, not to save it. But you see, Israel's God never had a character flaw. He is holy and always has been and always will be. And God is active in history. He punishes the wicked and vindicates his righteous. To a prophet, the greatest heresy imaginable would have to presume that God was absent from this world and incapable of intervening at any given moment. For some reason, we see all of this stuff going on, and the question comes up, where is God? He's all over the place, folks. He is active. He is doing exactly what he needs to do to bring about the plan that he has for this world. And like I said, I've read the end of the book, and I know what the plan is. There's going to be some terrible time of struggle. There's going to be persecution. We're going to see some hard times come. And then he's going to rapture the church out of here. And when he does that, that means that we will be looking down, watching this all take place. There will be others that will be saved during the tribulation. And they will become martyrs for the cause of Christ. And once that time comes and God sends Jesus back to set his foot upon the Mount of Olives, that hill will split in two, as the Bible says it will, and he will have conquered all that has been troubling earth for a long time. And for 1,000 years after that, he'll rule and reign here upon this earth with those that have believed and those that haven't yet believed. There'll still be some that have believed. And after 1,000 years, the Bible says that Satan will be loosed because he's bound up at that point in time. And when that 1,000 years is over, God's going to say, that's enough. I've had enough of this silliness. It's time Satan and all those who followed him are cast into the lake of fire. It's over in Revelation's 19th chapter. And he said that he will bring about a new heaven and a new earth. I know what's going to happen. And I'm part of it because I know who Jesus is in my life. That's the key, my friends. I can prophesy with certainty because it's what the Word of God says. Also, we know this about God and His message. God is merciful and redemptive. Both Old Testament prophets and modern-day preachers are responsible for condemning sin. But they must also communicate God's love and mercy to repentant sinners. A vital part of every Old Testament prophet's message was God's redemptive work. And today's message needs to be the same. That God is a redemptive God. God is a forgiving God. But God does judge sin. Somehow or another, we've got a disconnect there. We think that we can go on sinning and still receive the mercy of God. No, it won't happen that way. When you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in Him and confess His resurrection, the Bible says you can be saved. But it also means, and a part of that overall confession is repentance from your sin. It means you're going to stop what you've been doing. I like one little segment that I watched one time. A young preacher got up, looked over his notes, and says, "Stop it, church!" I said, got curious eyes. He said, "Stop sinning. That's what the Bible says. Jesus died for our sins. Stop sinning." And he sat down. It was a good message. He got to the point. We can't continue to sin if we've accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior. Because what He has saved us from is the act of habitual sinning. That doesn't mean we won't slip once in a while. But it means to get up, confess as you come up, and stand up and start following again. That's what the Word of God says. And as prophets, we need to preach against sin and for redemption. Your job as a Christian is also to do that. So the conclusion is this. The prophets spoke forth the Word in their day that they lived. But their word spanned the time of mankind's history. A prophet foretells and forthtells. He foretells concerning the day and time that he lives in. When we preach the Word of God in His redemptive power and Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we are forthtelling. When we also preach the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are forthtelling. Because that's future. And we know it to be true because God's Word said it's true. Jesus said, "I'm coming back to get you." He told His disciples that. He promised that as He ascended into the heavens. He promised to have the Holy Spirit with us from that time on until the time that He comes back. So when we tell somebody else about that, we are foretelling the future to come. Jesus is precious. His Word is precious. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away. Winter something about that name. If Jesus is a part of your life, my friends, praise God. Right now is the time to come and accept Him.